Hey, Nick, welcome to the show. As a way of getting started, tell us about yourself.
Hey, Brian. Hey, thanks a lot for having me. I really appreciate it. So I am a sales rep right now. I work for Salesforce.com. So I'm in our strategic group and key accounts. And if you're familiar with Salesforce, CRM organization, we do a lot beyond CRM. Mainly we do customer engagement and partner ecosystem engagement. So I've been there for about the last 8 years. And if you've seen the run that we're on, it's been a great place to work.
Yeah. And do you sell the whole portfolio or is it the whole portfolio?
And absolutely. Core rep. So I have the whole portfolio, the quarterback and all the specialists and group behind me.
Great. And what's your territory?
In Chicago. So I have two accounts. I have Exelon and Navistar.
That's it?
Yep.
So what do you focus on?
It's a large complex sales. So there's a lot to focus in on. And with our suite of solutions that we have, there's never a dull moment.
Yeah. And so how do you spend your day then? I mean, because you got two accounts, do you have them wherever they are?
Absolutely. Globally.
Okay. And does that mean you travel globally or?
Mainly North America, but if there's, I'd say 1% chance if you're getting out of the country for something very strategic, depending on where decisions are, where a meeting may be.
And how do you go about that? Meaning that, because most people, I call on 5-10 people a day. You definitely have to have a strategy. You definitely have to have a plan and you can't be responsive. You got to be proactive.
Yes, absolutely. So I'm a big believer in balancing long-term, midterm, and then near-term strategies. And so that's working when you're thinking about a pipeline. I'm working on cycles that are right now. How do we execute? But then 30% of my day is, well, what am I going to do in 18 months? What am I building for 24 months and how am I building more relationships to maybe get me in a position to be successful in the long term, not just the near. So I'm balancing my day by not being reactionary, but what am I focused in on right now? What's then that maybe 6 to 9 to 12 months? And then what's past that?
And is it to get more people using the core product or is it to get more products on top of it or both?
All of the above. So more out of what we already have in place. So we work with a lot of sales groups is probably the spoon that we'll sell first of the play setting. And so how do we add more automation into that? How do we add more intelligence into that with AI, other types of solutions, CPQ, those types of things that'll make a salesperson's life better. But then we naturally expand into service or we'll naturally expand into other parts of the business. When you look at CRM, it's not just the people talking to the customer, whether they're sales or service. That customer experience and your partner experience is impacted by all the levels deep in your organization that a sales guy like me is waiting on a quote to get approved or finance or somebody to do something. So how do we get all of those folks as part of that experience? More in an experiential kind of led design effort to really create that type of demand.
And is it a challenge? Because I worked, my company got acquired by a portfolio company and there was just a lot of coordination. And sometimes, the account executive didn't want anyone calling into the account. They wanted to be a gatekeeper. How do you manage? And are you guys at a matrix type organization?
Yeah. Everyone does that. Everybody's in a matrix organization and we don't fight internally. Right.
Don't admit to it.
Yeah, right. So for me, it's the same with customers. I mean, how do you build a relationship? It's all on trust in the beginning. It's all on transparency and it's all on you can trust that what I'm telling you is the truth, but I'm also going to be vulnerable and I'm going to listen to your opinions and we're going to try to become a team. For me, having this much matrix internally, it's really incumbent on me to be extremely organized and communicate effectively. But it's also to create an atmosphere that internally we can have those fights. We can be in a room with 18 people and have a whiteboard and we can, throw down, right? Do a little bit of Hunger Games on your solution. Why should it be in here? Why shouldn't it be? Versus taking that laundry to the customer. I think when you're in front of the customer, that's when I think it fails more than anything else.
Right. And is there any kind of end running or is there any protocol that you have to establish?
Nothing defined. I think that's, quarterback AE like I am to quarterback AE, but I definitely try to create that kind of protocol and trust that I'm here to enable you and put you in a position to succeed if you're a co-primer selling into the accounts. Yeah. But we have to have trust. What's the strategy? What's the outcome? How does that layer into the overall strategy that I don't want to say I own, but we as an account team should all agree to own?
Yeah. And how do you get comped? Do you get comped on anything that Salesforce sells into those two accounts?
Yes, absolutely. And so when we're in those Hunger Game moments, I'll bring in an architect and I'll bring in our customer success manager and others that don't have a SKU bias. so that we can let the skew bias folks, you know, try to sell us in that Shark Tankish kind of experience of why should we have you in the proposal going forward?
Yeah. And who do you deal with on the client side? Do they try and pigeonhole you with somebody? A lot of times they assign somebody to manage you.
Customer to customer is different. I've had experiences where IT will own us as an application, which means I'm not allowed to talk to the business if that's the kind of relationship we're going to establish. And selling CRM, IT doesn't buy a lot. I mean, they do if they're told to by the business. So if I'm going to create demand, I'm creating it over in the business. So the head of sales, head of service, or head of operations, and getting all my lieutenants and champions to consensus around those real power decision makers.
And what's your major challenge every day?
For me, it's indecision. It's herding the cats. Yeah. It's FUD from partners and competitors. I mean, those are the constant things when I'm walking halls that I'm dealing with.
And are you the dominant vendor in both accounts?
One account we are, one account not at all. We have a major headwind with one of the other large vendors you'd know in the space.
Yeah. And what's that like?
Uphill battle at all days, all times. Yeah. That's where, you know, you talk about building relationships and building trust. Listen, offer up where I think our solutions are going to add value very much in a positive sense. And it's a lot of those, hey, why not just give us a chance? We're here to darken the sky. Look what we're doing in the market. You should be aware.
Now, this is probably dramatically different than your previous role at Sprint, or was it similar or?
No, different than Sprint. Sprint, I was never a global lead. So at Sprint, I was always in that co-prime role supporting into other accounts before I got into leadership the last couple of years I was there. So coming here and being the quarterback all the way through the 8 years is a little bit different than when I was at Sprint.
Yeah, because I would think, because I had friends who worked at like an MCI, but Sprint, they want to view you as a commodity. They're really pushing you in that direction where it's price, price, price.
That's all it was. And we were the number four player. We came up the number three once in a while in the market. So being number one allows you the ability to have a little patience and have some trust building exercises for the long term, for sure.
Yeah. And at what level do you work? Is it that the VP of sales? Is it VP of service, operations? Who do you get the most traction with?
So for me personally, I found in my career, I it's all the above in the sense of the guy that works on the docks all the way to the CEO of the organization or the chairman group. It just depends on what the objective is. To get anything done, we have to be at power. And that's going to be CFO, C-suite of somebody. But the champions, the ones that stick their neck out, are going to be that VP of service or maybe a president of a service group, those types of titles. Because they're going to get more quota. And when I'm selling, you know, we're going to sell more. Okay, well, that means more quota. We're just not going to pay everybody on the same, comp plan that we had. And in service, they're going to be expected to deliver more somehow, deliver more to top line revenue, margin compression, maybe on the bottom, holding costs. And eventually we're going to get down to labor, right? Yeah. We have 1,000 people. We don't need 1,000 going forward. So if you do not have those folks in your business case aligned, you're guaranteed failure.
And do you do the implementation as well, or do you have a third-party partner? Or
typically, we'll have third-party partner, I'd say 90% of the time plus. We do have services, but our services are for the special scenarios, the biggest customers, the red accounts. We really got to step in and clean up maybe a mess from a partner.
Yeah.
Typically, we'll get involved. But I'm still a project manager. If I'm not engaged after I sell, the next sale's not coming.
Right. Yeah. Cool. And did you choose this role? Is this what you wanted?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Why?
When I came from Sprint, I hadn't sold the product. It was IT, and it was not just IT. It was pigeonholed IT, right? I mean, it was communication. It's just access and handsets. So it was not a sexy sale by any stretch. Now we're selling to organizations and the whole organization. You can really impact everything. You can impact their customer engagement, their partner engagement. That's very compelling. And so I've had career goals the last few years, personal ones, right? I have 11-year-old twins, so I want to get through some coaching and other things. But I also wanted to dominate a couple of accounts and really show that we were at the C-suite and we would be their number one vendor. And so I was able to do that in the last few years. So now I'm in the path of looking into leadership. So chose that quarterback, individual contributor, and now I'm looking to, you know, pass those skills on to others and lead a team into that kind of success.
And I'm sure you see a lot of reps, right? And a lot of junior reps. What differentiates the A players from the B players from your perspective?
There's a couple of things. For me, the first thing is getting to power and what that means. People are just entirely scared to get to power to understand how we can align to their top objectives. They sit in the 10K in other places, but you really got to understand them from all their lieutenants and then from them personally. They're just scared when you come in, you don't know the solution. The other one is they don't know how to leverage their resources. Typically, when they come in, we're bringing the farm. We've all heard the Oracle bus, like those types of rumors that are out there, which I'm okay with the bus. You want to darken the skies with resources because we're invested in a customer, but why? What is the role for everybody on what we're doing in those meetings, right? So they'll drain our resources that then hurt when I want to put a resource in the right place, and you know that can't get their time because the new person has them on every meeting because they don't know what they're doing.
Yeah. I can't tell you the number of meetings I remember where all of a sudden this person you never met before shows up, sits in the back of the room and plays with their cell phone and just wanted to have that check that they were at that meeting. And the client is like, who are you? Why are you here? And I think it was just too much either butt covering or just showing up instead of contributing.
Yes. And I can't tell you how much, and you've probably seen this where, you know, hey, Nick, do you have any meetings I can come in on? Or, hey, Nick, did you know our product's attach rate is 70% on what you're selling right now? Yeah. And so that's what I described earlier about the Hunger Games internally. The good ones that are going to support your account, hey, bring me who we should be calling. Go research a little bit. This is a big bet. And what would be your point of view for your solution?
Right.
If you can't do that internally, then why are you coming to the meeting? You're a wild card and a risk to me then.
Yeah. And are they just too focused on, you know, what we do instead of what we can do for you, understanding their problem and being able to talk about what they care about?
Absolutely. And not even starting with me, let alone before we even get to the customer. Like, hey, Nick, how do I help you be successful? Here's where I think I could fit into your accounts. Let me do some more research, come in a point of view. And then, yeah, I'm a gatekeeper, but not a negative one, right? Not like a cold calling gatekeeper. I'm here to put you in position so I can scale. Right. That's when I hit 300% of my number. I have five people actually selling, just aligned and selling into a common theme.
Instead of just trying to get on that year-end bill of materials.
Yeah, that's that you're getting paid for what I'm selling, but that's not, I mean, that's the system, but man, you know, give me some 1X here, multipliers going on.
Yeah, yeah. And how do you stay capable of communicating with the C-suite about what they care about?
So for me, it's all about trust at those VPs and director levels or senior vice presidents, the folks that I can really build beyond, I'll call it a text relationship. And we're all there now. If you can text somebody and you have a back and forth text, that is a much different relationship than anything else there is. And so having those folks that provide guidance, the coaching, the mentorship inside of an account, that's what I find I do role playing then. Here's the point of view. Here's the proposal we're going to put in front of your CFO. What do you think? This 80% is good. They'll crush this. They'll crush this. They'll crush this. Without that guidance, I think you just extend your cycles or even you lose out on future cycles because you burned it the one time you had.
And how do you earn that trust? What do they care about? What do they want to hear from a person like you?
For me, they need to understand first that I'm listening and that I care. So that I personally care about their individual success, that I care about how they're viewed inside their organization. And then I actually care that they're going to be able to impact either their internal customers, external customers, whatever it might be. Once we've gotten to that point, then I'm a trusted advisor, it's a term thrown around way too loosely. Yeah. But what that means is you'd reach out to me as we're a family to see if something's worth doing. And if I can get to there, we're going to have a long-term path of a lot of fun together.
Yeah. And do you have a particular method to get to that texting level? Because I agree with you 100% because that's immediate. It's not email. And if someone doesn't reply to your text, you know exactly what that means.
Yeah, you're not in their circle. You're not anywhere close to their circle, right? I don't think I have a methodology outside of, I learned really early on in my sales career when I was trying to be a salesperson that I turned everybody off around me because I was acting and it gave a sense of who's this person.
They're phoniness.
Yeah, phony, exactly. Once I started in my late 20s learning how to be myself, I think that's just, you know, I'm just my own personality. And so humor, being vulnerable in meetings. So I have a lot of technical people and architects that'll sit in meetings on both their side and mine. And I'm always the dumbest person in the room. You know, I'm there in relationships. I have a credit card, an expense account, and I can bring these people. And, you know, right. You laugh, like that laughter ends up being something endearing. And then we take that into different places.
So you've never tried to be the super technical guy?
I dive in technically, but I've realized that as soon as I try to be a super technical guy, I'm going to have limitations. I've never done that job.
Yeah.
But I can be situationally aware. I can have empathy for what the IT architects are doing. And then I can hear things in meetings, which is, for me, that's my job, to tie in those critical points that might happen three times in a big meeting. But that's what pushes a sales cycle along for me.
Yeah. And how about things like the classic budget issues and stuff? What's it, do you have a yearly cycle? Do you understand their financial model and when they spend money and their planning cycle? How do you dig into that?
Well, that's building the relationships and navigating through and just knowing that those are things you have to know. And so for me, if they have a budget, that's low hanging fruit. Anything transformational I've ever done in my career, though, there was never been a budget. They didn't know they needed the budget. They knew they needed to do something, but everybody's too scared to put a budget around a transformational project.
Yeah.
So I listen to budget just to be aware, but it doesn't motivate or drive me, right, as far as what I'm trying to do in a new account.
Right. And I think people get tied up on the difference between budget and capital, right? They don't have the budget for it, but you know how much money they have in the bank.
Yeah. It's only a few million dollars if you're talking to the right level. I've never found there not to be, right?
Yeah. And now with that, probably even the people you're talking to don't have sign off for that.
No, most of the time they do not. And if you want to do something transformational, it's CFO, it's CEO, and typically they're going to go to the board as well.
Yeah. And how do you prepare that? Because I've been there and there's no ending to not just approvers, influencers, but recommenders and advice givers.
It's a complex maze. I mean, that's when they threw the phrase out there, herding the cats. That to me is like on the front end, you're trying to herd the cats to get around something, but closing the deal, that thrill of the kill at the end there, that's the biggest challenge. I think it's really on your coaches that you have and the relationships you've built in the account. But I also think I bring a lot of resources. So we have a business value solutions group, you know, people from Harvard and University of Chicago Booth that really know what they're doing. And I've learned a lot from them, but my job is to align them with the CFO early on in that process. So we know what are going to be the KPIs, what are going to be the decision variables. So we hopefully shrink some of those, but we also know no matter what you do, cold feet are coming, man, right? Timing, cold feet.
Right. They talk to their spouses, they talk to their neighbors, they talk to their buddies.
Country club.
Yeah. And all those people, they don't approve it, but they have opinions.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, I just bought a bunch of appliances for our kitchen and I had cold feet trying, you know, you're looking at what you're going to sign off on and it's not millions of dollars, but it's still cold feet going, all right, until you just decide to do it. And there's a little bit of a leap of faith. And that's really where trust comes in.
And I'm sure it's not just a proposal that you give them. How do you justify it economically, align it with their business, do a ROI years out? How do you put that together in a package so that the CEO or the board of directors can look at it and say, look, they did their due diligence. This is not just somebody looking to get a new refrigerator. This is, you know, a game changer for the business. And I'm sure the CFO wants it, you know, buttoned up.
Absolutely. So for us, I mean, it's an executive summary that makes it very, very easy for an executive to see and read. And then everything beyond there is all the details. So executive summary is going to have exactly what you described. What are your top objectives? What's holding you back? And how is this solution going to directly help you? Then we're going to get into the finances of why this is something that's important, both from a cost side and an ROI. And typically we're focused on a 12-month ROI that is like the green high bar. That's what we find most CFOs are. What am I getting back immediately? And then we'll put a 5-year on there, focus on years 2 and 3. Years 4 and 5, selling software like we do, I mean, those are changing. I mean, in a year, that plan's going to change anyways, right? And we're very open about that. The key for us, though, the biggest confusion in our marketplace is how do I get started? It's extremely complex saying, I have all these systems. You're going to bring all this value, but what am I taking down first? What am I putting up first? What capabilities, which all translate to ROI and how it's hitting my top priorities that we started off with. Yeah. And so for us, that's a lot of deep immersion with their teams, both the integration team, the business units, the IT group, and putting that plan. But that's the appendix. But the executive summary doesn't mean everything if every lieutenant's not raising their hand saying, we support this, right? I support the capability. I support the impact of the business. But more importantly, the business plan, like I said earlier, a sales leader is going to have to take on more quota and a service leader is going to have to help with margins somehow and deliver more revenue as well. Nowadays, they're not just a cost center. They're going to have to help on that top line. And so that to me is a real in-depth effort to get there. But once you do get there, it buttons up very nicely.
And how do you manage the year? Because, you know, I've dealt with a lot of people in your role, and it's very back-end loaded, where like 80, 90% of their comp comes in 1 month.
Yeah, we just had that discussion this morning on a team call. Yep.
You know, how do you keep the energy going? How do you keep your managers at bay? How do you keep psyched and focused when it's, you know, kind of all or nothing?
You know, it's a challenge. And working at Salesforce, the first quarter, this is, I've been here long enough. So for me, it's easy to take the emotions out of it because you've just seen the muscle get flexed too many times. Our first quarter, we're changing territories and you're kind of lining up for you. Second quarter is all about activity. What do you have in the app and what are we doing? And what are the meetings? Third quarter, if you're familiar with us in our Dreamforce event, which is actually in a couple of weeks now. So it's fourth quarter this year, but typically it's third. But all we've heard about is who's the engagement, who's attending, what are your plans? And then fourth quarter is head downs, close everything. Yeah. And so for us, because the business has already been cadenced this way so long, we have renewals, compelling events, and things that are really coming up in Q4 to help with that closing. But for me, being around, I mentor a lot of folks, so that I, you know, the spiel you're getting right now is the exact same one they get. Don't worry, this is what we're getting this in Q1, and this is what you have to build up for to make your year go. You know, having a CRM, though, that we have one view of our customers and our opportunities and all of our folks lined up in one place, I think it really gives us an advantage to contextually kind of move forward when it gets, you know, when the fan starts really getting all the crap hitting it, right? Yeah. Which invariably is going to come and is starting now for us, for sure.
And when you get the contrast of an account that you essentially own or you're dominant in, and then an account where you're not, you know, with the one you're not, it's a totally different headspace, right? You're the underdog. Yes. You're the one trying to find a little piece of land to to plant your seed in and spread. How do you find that when the executives have their name attached to your competitor?
It's always a challenge. You put land and expand. Cloud software is fantastic to be able to land and expand, right? We can have standalone solutions. We don't have to be complex. And shadow IT is your friend up to a point, right? So I really thrive in those types of accounts with shadow IT. What I love about our organization and our ecosystem is our customers do a lot of selling for us. They really believe in our solution and it really brings value to them. So if I have a customer that's really adopting and one that's not, my number one goal is to start connecting them because I'm the common thread in my account team. So trust then comes along with that as well as value. They're also getting some personal networking and professional networking out of it. So for me, that has shrunk cycles faster than anything else that I've been able to do.
And are you looking for that champion, kind of the rebel within that account, the person that's willing to have a personal win to go with you guys, to switch from somebody else or to bring in a different vendor? Because I've seen, you know, a lot of these accounts, they are, you know, HP, IBM, or Oracle accounts, right? And I'm sure you see that, right? Oh, yeah. And then sometimes it doesn't matter if your product's free, they're not going to use it. Right?
Free like puppies, right?
Yeah. and sometimes you're like, well, in your case, you can't walk because you got two accounts.
Right.
Right. You know, if you had the whole state of Illinois, it's a whole different story.
Absolutely. It makes it a challenge, but for me, that's where you have to have the long-term approach. You have to have patience. You have to believe in what we have. And it's a lot of internet scraping in the sense of like LinkedIn, new jobs, who's been hired new. Yeah. There's a lot of looking, what kind of jobs are they hiring for? And you are just looking for, I used to laugh when I was younger, and it's not a good phrase to say, but I'm looking for the person that hates their company as much as I do. But I laughingly say that where they hate the way they're doing it. They hate the current vendor. They hate hearing, you know, I can't think of the name for it, but it's just the culture says we've always done it that way. And so when you find somebody that says, I don't want to do it that way, how do we nurture that? How do we support them in their career growth? And that ends up being a healthy partnership.
Yeah, I think
so that's a lot of variables, but.
That new executive who comes in, and usually they want to make a change. They want to put a feather in their hat and they want something and they can't get it with the current incumbent.
That's exactly right.
Yeah. And kind of build with them. Now, people recommended you for the podcast. Why do you think they did that?
Well, I think hopefully it's a lot of the stuff you're hearing here that I've built big relationships and long-term relationships. But, you know, I'm not saying the people that you work with are friends and work your customers are, but you really have to approach in that way. And I think when you start really building some relationships and having experiences that are outside of work, inside of work, and people know that you care, you keep those around for a long time. And I think those are traits that don't exist in our industry and in our profession enough, right?
Because sales isn't known for its longevity.
In an account or on an account or right.
In a company.
Care a lot, that's for sure, right?
Yeah. And why did you take that approach versus kind of hop, skip, and jump to the hottest new thing?
I just think it's the most stable way. And as I've done it, you become an expert in what you're doing. It allows me to be calm. It allows me to be patient. It allows me to leverage that and really know when I see an opportunity that could really grow and has no ceiling to really put all my eggs into that side.
Cool. Hey, it's been a great conversation. Where can people go to follow you?
I'm on LinkedIn, and Nick Antifanis on LinkedIn, and I don't have any podcasts or anything like that. Anywhere else you can follow?
No books, no public speaking.
No books or public speaking yet, but maybe in the future, definitely.